Human sustainability. We'll talk about that on this episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast.
The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guest and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
This episode is brought to you by Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital is a business lender matching platform. Avoid the mystery of one-sided deals. Connect with Fundwise to get the very best funding you can qualify for fast. You can apply online in 60 seconds or less, and there's no effect to your credit to see how much you can get. It's easy. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. You did hear me correctly. I did say start or grow your business. If you don't have a business yet, you got a solid business plan, they can help you get funding. Get the best funding you can qualify for. Their strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months. Unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, and bridge loans. They work with real estate, startups like I already mentioned, franchises, restaurants, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started, it's really easy. Just go to apply.fundwise.com/minddog. That's apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Get money for your business now. Apply.fundwise.com/minddog.
Is everybody ready for the Mind Dog, the magnificent show?
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. I don't know what's going on with the technical stuff lately, but we'll get it. Get our ducks back in a row. Tonight, this might be the most interesting, at least for me, episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast I've ever done. And that's saying a lot because I think we're technically up to 875 right now with this broadcast, but with including the morning broadcast, well over 1,000. So saying a lot. Tonight we're going to talk about human sustainability, and if you know me, you probably surmise that I'm a pessimist at worst and a realist at best. Don't have a lot of optimism for this, but it is a subject that we've talked about in some respect, a lot, and a lot lately. On Monday night, I think it was Monday night, I lose track of the nights now. Monday night, we talked about a book called Currency, which talks about human value systems and big changes in the way humanity approaches each other and the idea of sustainability. So we're going to talk about that tonight. Anthony Wall is the founder and president of Noēsis, a humanitarian nonprofit dedicated to issues of human sustainability. Wall spent much of his career in the financial services industry, but continually found himself drawn back to the study of humankind. In 2019, he established Noēsis and created a series of educational videos to explain how primitive compulsions continue to drive modern interaction. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Anthony A. Wall to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Tony, can I call you Tony?
I most certainly go by Tony, and thank you for the very nice words at the beginning, that the idea that I would be one of your best shows. I hope to deliver.
I think you will. You know what, and I'm not saying everybody, but for me, this, because I am extremely interested in this, even though I describe myself as a pessimist, I'd like to be an optimist if I could be, and so maybe you can help me get there. But first of all, I gotta say, I grew up with five brothers named Wall, friends of mine, and you look a lot and sound like all of them, so I'm wondering if there might be a relation. I know it's a pretty common name, but Long Island, New York, any relatives out here?
No, but there's a lot of male uncles I never met. They're all, I have cousins and second cousins out there I don't know exist.
All right. Okay. Well, it's possible. Just remind me a lot of the Wall brothers I grew up with. So, okay. So human sustainability, and a lot of this depends on hope and optimism in some sort. You had to be an optimist to even create this and look at this as if there was anything we can do to not go off the cliff. Would you describe yourself as an optimist?
I would. No, I would describe myself as a realist. Okay. You will come to understand that you and I are very well aligned there. What we do here, it lives in the real world. We do not bring value of any kind in soft peddling these issues, as you will see.
Right. The other night, I elaborated this in a way that got me some hate mail. And every time I use the word globalist, it gets me hate mail from people. But I think globalism is at the root of this idea. Is it not? Is it because, and I'll expand on that a little bit, that conflict, human conflict, is inevitable as long as we draw boundaries between people. Is it not?
It is, but I want to put this in place very quickly. I'm going to be really happy to surprise you and your listeners by a lot of things that you're going to find out here. We are evolutionary scientists. We don't do theory. The human race that is put upon, we can agree, a very put upon human race has no luxury of theory, Matt. And we don't do theory. And you will find what you're about to hear is full of hope and remedy. However, we are in deep, and I'm about to describe how deep we are, and then I'm going to tell you what the value of bad news is. The value of bad news brings clarity, and that's what we need.
Okay. So now all of this noesis and where it comes from, basically, the starting point is this idea of human injury, right? Can we explain that to people, or is that jumping the gun? Is there something?
No, not at all. As a matter of fact, I think it's a good idea to layer it in and go from there. We have a book coming out called The Human Injury. It describes a crossover period in the human evolutionary timeline that once you see it, you can't unsee it, Matt. You'll see what I mean. We can shine a light on the evolutionary timeline of the human species that we never could before. Even 50 years ago, our timeline on this earth was a matter of some conjecture. As we speak, archaeologists understand the path of human migration in great, great detail. And I would say not a moment too soon. Human beings can learn who we really, really are for the first time ever. And I would suggest that we get busy. So we can determine the evolutionary reason for every single act we take in the modern day. And every act we do take does spring from a past reality. We can know them now, and that will be part of what we do. And that is evolutionary influence upon modern behavior, the totality of it, the weight of it, our inability to fight against the immensity of 200,000 prior generations of evolving humans, the impulses and compulsions there too, that are pressing down on our present moments, they activate 20 times faster than a thinking mind. So out of the gate, human beings are tasked with something we're really not up to without the data. The data that's now available, and that's what we're doing here.
Now you got me a little bit confused. Where does the data come from? Are you talking about archaeology and studying the...
Yeah. Keep asking questions like that, because there's so much we do here. It's a lot to unpack.
Yeah, I agree.
By all means, take me to task in any way you wish. Human beings, what we are at heart, we came off of a 275,000 year migratory period where we all began in the same place. That's no longer a conjecture. If we're going to be problem solving for human sustainability, we need to have certain assumptions in place. They are these: human beings, in fact, evolved on planet Earth. We also have a common starting place. Again, something that's not conjecture. We all started in the Central African Congo Basin. So right away, what have we done? Right away out of the chute, we've gotten all 8 billion human beings traced back to the same place. So that's what we need to do first, and that's what we have. Now, it's interesting. I want to put this in place, Matt. If someone comes and says, I don't believe in evolution,
that's where I was going to go.
I will say the following. I will defend anybody's right to believe whatever they wish. However, it is our central assumption here for the purposes of problem solving for human sustainability that humans evolved on this planet and that we all come from the same place. So it's a real good way to get us all on the same page. And now we find ourselves at each other's throats, which I might add is not natural behavior for human beings, as we will all come to know as we continue this.
I want to kind of try to articulate the idea that I have in my mind here. Now, I agree with you. Obviously, I think most people who have any sense of where we are now in the world of understanding agree with the theory of evolution, even though, and some people will say it's just a theory, but there's no such, just a theory. And you said in the beginning, we can't afford the luxury of theory, but right. Theory, evolutionary theory is still a theory. It's that far away from law, but we can't ever call it a law, but it is theory. But because we can't call it a law, there are, I don't know what the numbers are, but there is a large segment of the population that still is creationism. As you mentioned, people can believe whatever they want. But if you say for the purposes just of problem solving, adopt this idea of evolution, they'll say, no, that's the devil talking. You're evil. You're satanic. That's what the devil wants us to, creationist.
And to them, I say again, I will fight alongside of them to protect their right to believe exactly that. Who are we to ask anybody to retire or to put aside the beliefs that are so central to all of us? When I get done fighting for your right to believe whatever you wish, we get back to the central assumptions here. And that is that human beings, in fact, evolved on planet Earth, and that we have our place in Central Africa. So let's go from there.
Wait, before you move on, can I just ask to clarify this? Is it not essential to have those people on board? Is that what you're saying, to have them completely on board with this idea of evolution? Because that's the stumbling block, I think.
The answer is, again, to be frank with you, there are many, many stumbling blocks. The idea that 65% of people in the world are, in fact, uncomfortable with evolution is problematic. I can't say anything. I would bring no value if I didn't say that straight out.
Right, but we don't need them on board to come to this conclusion. That's what I'm asking.
We don't. It's a not a way. I think you understand what I mean here. It's not the way I would put it, but in general, yes. Okay. You know, we are going to ask human beings to put aside the false bravado that's not working for us. Okay. And admit our helplessness. This comes from a caring, a very caring.
I understand. Believe me, I'm with you, but I do this every day. Mm-hmm. And when I put that out there, the amount of hate mail I get, I'm sure you probably get some too, but,
I'm ready, and I'm ready to surprise some people here too. Let's start right now with surprising some people. We come from the place where we have, in fact, we have a journey on Earth that is now well known in great detail. Now, we fancy ourselves, modern humans fancy ourselves to be flawed. No, we are not. What I'm going to explain to you will explain to human beings a big, big surprise, and one I could show, one I will defend, and one that we hold out as inarguable, and that is that we are injured. And if I say something like that, I better darn well be able to defend it. So
no, I don't think anybody would. I'm surprised anybody would argue with you about that. But continue. I'm sorry to interrupt. Because that seemed like an obvious truth to me, and I can't imagine anybody saying no.
Well, self-loathing looks at human beings as flawed. No. We look at the human. We look at the lost and frightened human race as an injured and frightened race. This is empathy. We view the human race. We are in trouble. Okay. We are injured. We are frightened, and we are acting every bit of it. Okay. So right there, we come from a place of empathy and fact. Empathy applies. And here's what doesn't apply: blame and judgment. Neither have utility of any kind, nor do human beings respond to either. Okay, so the minute we start blaming human beings, that's the minute we get turned off, and that's the minute we get hate mail, because right. Human beings do not respond to blame, but human beings will respond to an explanation, and here it is. About 10 to 20,000 years ago, human beings were coming off of this migratory journey to all areas of the globe. This journey took place in a highly collaborative, highly cooperative spirit. How collaborative? Let me explain. Collaborate or die. We needed to be in tight-knit groups. We have it in our DNA, wound around our bones, to assist and to be assisted. That is who we are. That would run afoul of a crossover event that is, you will see, is completely, completely random in nature. Natural selection, by the way, relies heavily on luck, quite frankly. So we were unlucky. What do I mean? Well, about 10,000 years ago, we arrived to all areas of the globe, and we didn't have anywhere else to go. Here's a little bit of information that people might find a little surprising. The last leg of the migratory journey for human beings occurred only 30,000 years ago, when humans crossed over from what is now Northeast Russia to what is now Alaska. And then we made our ways into the Americas and finally into South America. So by 20,000 years ago, we were all over the globe by now. And there was only one thing to do, and that was to settle into larger and larger populations. Now, I want to stop here, and I want to explain that I just set up something that went from migratory to stationary.
Right. I get that. And I definitely get that. And I wanted, because you laid out also that it was collaborative in nature, I'm trying to wrap my head around this whole concept. In order for people to kind of be on a mission to do this, I mean, collaborative effort means they're together on a common goal. They have to understand that there's this larger world out there. And that, to me, is not, that doesn't jive with my thinking that of ancient understanding of the world, that they'd have to know, like if you started in the Congo or in Africa, have to know that South America exists and the Alaska land bridge to Russia exists to have that collaborative effort. No, or am I getting way off track here?
Not off track in any way. No, there's. I will just continue in a logical flow, and what you say is itself logical. So by all means, continue. I want to point something out. Only 200 years ago did human beings deduce that we evolved. Only 200 years ago. Now, this meant that all human beings, the human groups that came in contact with one another in before 200 years ago, they may as well, when we saw human groups that were strange, they may as well have been aliens from outer space. Who knew that we all came from the same place? So the fact that we were came into conflict and that we defaulted to survival, to defense, is no stretch. We had no way of understanding this. We certainly do now, and now we can get something done. But let me go back to the injury. The point of injury, human beings are injured. I will show it. Here it is. Once you see it, you'll never unsee it, okay? Human beings have collaboration in our DNA. When we settled into larger and larger groups, we domesticated large animals. We grew larger and larger fields of crops. We domesticated pack animals like dogs to manage our beasts of burden. And now our populations grew and grew and grew. And now stationary cultures took over from migratory cultures. And what did they do? They took up behaviors of acquisition. And here's where the trouble began. Specifically, the acquisitive behavior. Again, this is all very, Matt, this is random events here. Nobody got together and said, let's torpedo the whole.
No, I get that.
Yeah, we didn't know. We just didn't know. I want to stress that. We didn't know. So these acquisitive behaviors, they defaulted to the creation of a financial meritocracy. A meritocracy intruded upon the human experience for the first time. What do I mean by meritocracy? This term catches people up, and I need to hover here. A meritocracy is, in this case, a financial meritocracy. It created lesser and greater beings. A class-based meritocracy between me and you in the fence post, Matt, we can agree that we live in a democracy, but what's truer, that we live in a democracy or a financial meritocracy? I think we can agree easily. People don't think of things like that. So what did a meritocracy bring into the human experience? It brought a class-based hierarchy of value. Mm-hmm. For the first time, equal beings rolling along in a collaborative fashion, needing one another. Now we're commanded to acquire, and greater and lesser beings were created. Now, a lesser being doesn't know what that means in its DNA. So acquisitive behavior was no less than a torpedo to the bow of human DNA. We're talking about biology here, right? Not blame. So if we can understand ourselves as having been literally injured, our hearts were broken. Yeah. Lesser beings didn't know what lesser meant. Greater beings would press that delusion down upon lesser beings. And this was a washing machine that would go on to disassemble every single stationary human culture to ever exist on this planet. And there have been 70. So, acquisitive meritocracy is 70 and 0 in defeating human stationary cultures. It's knowable. It's what I just said is knowable now for the
It makes sense. It makes sense to me. And I agree with it because I'm inclined to agree with it. I think we're back to, and I don't want to jump the gun here, but if we're back to solution based thinking, the solution would seem to be to give up that acquisition-based culture, no?
No, thank you for cueing me quite nicely there. I got to give it to you here. No, I'm going to, again, here, I get the surprise here again, didn't I? Promised I would. Capitalism is our only choice because sentient creatures must be free. Okay, capitalism is the only choice for us, but we unknowingly, unwittingly created lesser beings within a meritocracy, and the lesser beings defaulted to resentment for the first time. Resentment introduced itself into the human experience for the first time, and now a mathematical constant intruded. Here's the constant. It works just like this. It's undefeated. Resentment has always defaulted to a vengeance. Vengeance always executes upon insurgency. We are mathematically preordained to fail out of the gate until we understand what is now knowable. And that is that we are nursing no less than broken hearts. Now, that's a term that you're going to want me to add to, you know, a term like broken hearts. Please, Tony. No, I want to explain how serious I am about this. We are acting vaguely unnatural relative to our migratory DNA. Would I go as far as to say that we've devolved? Well, let me ask you a question. If somebody becomes ill and then their condition worsens, I'm going to go out on a limb and say that they've devolved medically. So human beings have devolved, and I can point to one thing that proves it. That is that we are a failed culture, and that the mortality of the most remarkable species in the galaxy is vaguely viewable to everyone. And when that's true, and when that's no longer a sell, human sustainability is something whose time has come.
All right, wait, you gotta, because if you're talking about, you just confused me. You're talking about human beings evolving. We were evolving, and at some point we started devolving. Have you identified that point from where evolution started and de-evolution?
Well, I'm careful here because, you know, I'm talking to people. I want to make sure that I'm clear. I am what we hold our conclusions here to be inarguable. Why? Because we proceed only from fact or that which we can show to be true. What okay. can I show to be true? It's this. We're commanded to acquire for the first time 10 to 20,000 years ago. Our biology doesn't really know how to. It doesn't recognize a lesser being will spend its life escaping the lesser station assigned to it. It doesn't understand what lesser means. We evolved in a spirit of equality. So if you look up, by all means, please, any listener, do it right now. Look up reasons for societal collapse. There are two. It's a constant. Increasing complexity driven by inequality. Lesser beings acting out. Not by their decisions, but by an insult to their DNA.
Okay.
So we're bringing to the human race the ability to cross over from self-loathing that we've arrived at. We could easily agree here. We're acting suicidally. And over to empathy, like something, there's nothing wrong with us. Something happened to us. And it's knowable in great detail. We were derailed. And I've got a question. Has anybody seen a derailed train put itself back on the track?
No, of course not, right?
Right. So that's what we're here to do. We are here to explain to human beings what happened to us and then to actively preserve ourselves when we cross over from the self-loathing that we now act in over to viewing ourselves as helpless beings. We've got the weight of 200,000 previous generations of evolving humans before us, the impulses and compulsions that we think we banished to the basement. I got bad news. They're not thinking mechanisms. They're making the rules. So, you know, are we in deep? Yeah. Are we going to fail in a socio-mathematically certain way? Yeah. Do we need to? No. Not with what we now know.
Empathy. Is it part? Is it your belief? And I know we're not talking about theories here, but do you have evidence to back this up? That because I feel I have to tell you, I feel like empathy is on the decline as a human characteristic. I'm seeing more and more people who seem to not have any empathy. For instance, and I'll just give you. And I know some people are tired of hearing me talk about this. A couple of guys on a podcast, comedians talking about the homeless problem in LA, said, why don't you just shoot them? And I thought, well, there's no empathy in that, but it also puts the blame. It's the greater people, the millionaire, the 100 people with $100 million contracts, blaming the have not the lesser people in the paradigm that you set up, blaming them for, how dare they dirty up my world with their you know, their hardships and what has come on. So I think I look at that and I say, we as a society have seemed to have lost empathy. And I'm not sure if it's part of our DNA or if it's some people we're just becoming more narcissistic, antisocial, however you want to phrase that. And I know we're trying not to talk theory here, but that's my perception of the world, that we are losing empathy.
I bring something counterintuitive to that. There's a lot of counterintuitive things going on here. And in fact, counterintuitive is the new sheriff, as I'll explain. Because intuitive has failed us. We failed 70 times under the very models that are around us. The perpetual conflict is undefeated. So I want to make a point about the people, the coldest of hearts.
Yes.
The coldest of hearts, we don't see that. We see the most shattered of hearts. That's empathy. You show me the coldest of hearts, and I will show you a broken heart, protecting whatever sliver of it is left. We are.
That makes sense to me. I would agree with that. But at some point, the coldest of hearts need melting or repairing, and that's the issue, isn't it? I mean, we can't. That's a wound that it needs to be healed before we can even have hope or optimism for the future.
Well, this transports us very nicely. Thank you again. To what now? Well, never mind what's going on. What now?
Right.
What now is this? We were swept. We've been swept along for 10,000 years by an injury, greater and lesser beings. Look, Matt. Here's a fact. The human brain picks what's logical in its present moment. Everybody moves around the world logically, or we die. Like, hey, by all means, close your eyes tonight while you're driving home. Tell me how it works out. You know, it's okay to have a few laughs about this. This is not a dark undertaking, but we understand that the human brain chooses what's logical in its present moment. And yet, we rise from the ashes of all of our failed cultures, and what we start has a bad habit of looking like what we left behind, and quickly. This would indicate that we are not in our present minds. It would indicate that we are being manipulated, if you will, by evolutionary hallucinations. The idea that we are fighting enemies in our minds that died eons ago. And that, in fact, every single day, all 8 billion human beings are misinterpreting their environments greatly. And when you start with a misinterpretation, that means the starting gun kills our horse. How do we ever intend to get to a finish line called human sustainability when we're coming out of the gate misinterpreting everything we see? And then those we target will then come back with something that's even more misinterpreted. Why? To vanquish the threat, the one that's not there.
Well, I'm going to say that some people listening to this probably are confused right now. Are we talking about science? Are we talking about religion? We're talking about psychiatry, psychology. It's all kind of blending in here a little bit on some level, spirituality or whatever.
The human injury is not a buzz phrase. The human injury is real. When human beings crossed over from collaborative and cooperative over to acquisitive, and the rigors it stressed, we didn't recognize ourselves. We didn't recognize ourselves. We still don't, okay? There's a war going on in the human mind. We have a deep calling to assist and to be assisted. This is at war with the self-interested defaults of acquisitive behavior. So we can diagnose, we can look at the x-ray and we can see the dark spots now. We can understand how we got here for the first time. We can understand the mechanisms that drive our failures, and we can abandon blame and judgment. Why? Because here's why. They don't have any utility, and yet we monetized both. We monetized a serial killer of human cultures. Perpetual conflict is what we do. And perpetual conflict is 70-0 in disassembling and destroying every human culture ever to exist on this earth. These same models govern everything we do today. So let me be clear. We're in deep here. But what did I just give you? Bad news or clarity?
Well, you gave me clarity about understanding the past, but how do we use that to be problem solvers for the future?
This is where I get to greatly surprise again, I hope. So thank you very much for the segues. Where do you get value like this? So you're asking what now? All right, let's get to this. First of all, let me give you a couple of numbers, Matt, because we are mathematicians here. Here it is. During this conversation, about three species will go extinct. Earth loses 150 a day. 999.9% of all the things that ever lived on this earth are gone. And that's 5 billion extinctions if you're keeping score at home. Extinction is as common as breathing. So the first thing we need to do is demystify this entire thing. The idea that this couldn't happen to us is preposterous, as it is unnecessary. Okay, so this idea that human beings need to bottom out to find our comeuppance is nonsense. Not with what we know. Noēsis will not play. Okay. We're going to partner with every single country on this earth and all 8 billion people on this earth under a now forming banner. It's called species self-preservation. Let's look at the three banners we cannot and will not ever attempt to get together under. Number one, politically, please. Number two, religiously, again, no. Number three, culturally. We're not ready. But remember, we come from the same place. We are all in crisis together. And human beings historically unite under common enemies. Is the degradation of the human species not common enough? I believe we're about to find out.
Well, what do you mean? No, because it sounds when you said that common enemies, what is the
common enemy is the end of our species.
Okay. Yeah.
The end of our species is vaguely visible to all of us on the horizon. And when that's no longer a tough sell, it's time for a Noēsis or a Noēsis like entity. And this is another major point.
Well, the reason I asked, because people can interpret that in the way that, like, Ronald Reagan said about, imagine how we would all come together if an alien race or certainly posed an enemy to planet Earth. We would lose all our differences and come together in cooperation with that. So what you were saying kind of rang that bell a little bit. So when you say common enemy, I'm sure some people like me, mind triggers back to that. We're talking about UFO aliens and all that kind of stuff. I just want to be clear.
By the way, I love to talk to you about aliens. It's fascinating. We also teach human rarity here.
Right.
The Fermi paradox, the great filter. I can go on and on for hours about astronomy and astrophysics. I'd do it in my sleep if I could.
Right. But you're talking about here is big picture concepts. I'm thinking about the average person, practical steps that we can do. And maybe are we too soon to get
no, into- no, not at all. Let me answer your question. First of all, human sustainability will, the reason why I took you through all the numbers about extinction, the realities of extinction, it was for a good reason. Let me explain something. We are assigned, as we speak, we are assigned a mere 2-3% chance to make it through our technological childhood. And by the way, if we were to fail, this is empathy here, it would not mean that we failed. It would make us eminently normal in a cosmic sense. It is thought that that sentient intelligence throughout the galaxy tends to destroy itself the moment it can. And I would gently warn that this is called the great filter. Please look it up. Humans are up against the great filter now. This is the point at which astrophysicists believe correctly, I think, that sentient intelligence tends to destroy itself. So I've got a terrific challenge for the human race, and that is, let's be the first, perhaps the first, sentient intelligence ever to make it through the great filter.
Hmm.
So we teach human rarity here. One thing we do is human rarity. We don't understand how rare we are. Noesis will fix that. If I gave you a Monet, there isn't anybody that wouldn't take it up to Christie's in New York and take $50 million. We would all do this. And yet, we all step over human beings who may be the most rare being in the galaxy.
Right.
So I just gave a human being one heck of a promotion, didn't I?
Yeah.
And that's empathy. We view ourselves as flawed. We view ourselves as a scourge. It's nonsense. We are injured, frightened beings. We don't know how we got here. We don't know how we're leaving. What sentient being would not fear that reality? And what sentient being would not further fear the degradation of that reality? So that's a being that could use some empathy. Okay? We are not flawed. We're injured in ways that we can now view. So how's this going to look going into the future? It's going to take decades. Human beings need to learn the evolutionary triggers for all modern behavior. Once we know that, we can impose, we can determine what we do today and whether it has utility for us. Okay, so here's a great example. If you wouldn't mind, give me 30 seconds for this.
Absolutely.
Negative information. We have a video called Negative Information. Please bring it up. Human beings used bad news to stay alive during our migratory journey. Nobody with good news had value. The bearer of bad news had value, and we reported upon it, and we had value, and it gave us a buzz. Well, it reinvented, Matt. Now we gossip about people we call friends, and we shame them into privacy. You know what we're doing? We're still looking for negative information for our tribes that died eons ago. So we are answering ancient bells every day, and we wonder why we're in trouble. At Noesis, we don't. We are acting frightened, and we should be frightened. None of this, you know why it feels all wrong? It is all wrong in our DNA. We want to help what is helpless. That's what we do.
Gotcha. Here's my, and I hate to play the devil's advocate here, but I have to. You said in there, we have to learn about who we truly are. And I am of the, pretty much, you know, I feel this is something as strongly as you feel you're, there's no argument against the facts that you present. I think this is a fact, and I would be hard to argue me out of, is that in order to learn something, people have to want to learn something. Nobody ever learns something against their will. So part of the big challenge here is getting people to want to learn who we truly are. Yes or no?
Yes. And here's how I put it. What we've become has never, ever, ever survived. What we are deserves to survive. We are at heart deserves to survive. What we become has no chance. Because
I get that. And I don't think anybody listening to this program so far could absolutely argue with that at all. It seems like that's absolutely true. But in order to move forward now, people have to embrace these ideas. And in order for them to embrace these ideas, they have to want to kind of learn about them. That's the tough problem in my view. And you will see lots of resistance, and how you overcome that resistance.
Well, that's why I'm
a pessimist, by the way.
No, but by all means, please be one. I'm going to say what I said earlier. I better be able to defend this, and watch me. I'm tougher than cheap steak, Matt. I will get knocked down, and I will get back up again, and I will continue to get back up again until human beings.
Yeah, understand. I'm not sure. I don't want to knock you down.
No, not at all. You're terrific. Please. Right. I need to be taken to task. I say bring it, because I get to say this, an unreachable star, watch us, watch us. No, we will not play. The idea that we're just going to like fizzle away. No, not while I draw oxygen. No.
Right.
We know who we are for the first time. We can out all of the delusions that we have. It's not our fault. Let me give you the example. We say we're mathematical. What do I mean? Here's a good example. We do a series on ethics and morals. We make inconvenient points, Matt. Here's what it sounds like. We call ourselves ethical and moral, but then if we take a closer look, we need to admit to ourselves that ethics and morals are tailored almost precisely to the probability of negative consequences at any given moment. We're not ethical or unethical. We're more correctly mathematicians. if we understand what the chances of our bad behavior being detected is, we will tailor our morals and ethics precisely to it. Now, that's a hard thing to hear.
That's true. I would continue. I'm sorry. But okay, no, I agree.
So right there, just stay with that right there. You said, I see that. I get it.
Yeah.
But you don't see me blaming. You see me doing math.
Right.
So if human beings came to understand that these are vaguely delusions, then we could actually become ethical and moral as a matter of species survival. We would begin to understand what it takes for us to reach sustainability and understand that our delusions disallow it. Here's another piece of social math. Human decency. Let me make an inconvenient point. Decency tends to end at the point where action is required. So we are we're lip service junkies, aren't we?
Yeah. Now,
another thing that's hard on the ears, but we bring clarity. We bring no value by soft pedaling. Am I gonna get the ire of somebody who thinks we are ethical? Yes, I am, and I'm going to very, very calmly explain that. Listen, talk to me. I'm going to do the math for you. And if you can't do the math, I'm going to have to move on.
You got me wanting to ask, is this everything is judgment-free? Meaning, somebody's committed a great crime. Is there no judgment in any of that? Or is there just empathy for people who commit the worst atrocities?
Oh, no. I'm happy. I'm real happy you asked. No, everything that's going on around us descends from an injury that I've described and can greatly describe in detail. We crossed over to unnatural behavior relative to our migratory DNA. So everything we're doing right now, everything, is essentially descends from a psychic injury, undiagnosed, unresolved. So,
personal responsibility, though, for crime, for individual crimes or atrocities or bad deeds done, does that exist within this model?
Let me put it another way to you: if we become sick, let me talk about myself. If I contract an illness that needs to be treated, I have to live within the illness first to get better. Okay. So when you say, what about the people that do this and this within this model today? We must live within it and live in the real world and work toward what we need to be. The idea that we're going to have empathy for a serial killer is preposterous. We're going to throw them in jail is what we're going to do.
Okay.
We're also going to later say, if we look hard into any situation that is completely off the rails, we'll be able to find the injury. We will be able to find it every time. So can we look at everybody's injury? Of course not. This is macro humanism, Matt.
Okay. That's important because I understand that it's a macro humanism, but in order for us to, I think, move forward, individuals need a roadmap for what we can personally do.
Okay.
Individually.
And I've got a great answer for you. I think I do. I really do. So let's get to it. I remember a podcast I did a little while ago. This came flying out of my mouth and it darn well works. I said, here's what we can do right now. Notice the things that are going on around you and see them differently forever. What we think we're seeing is not what we're seeing. We are seeing political divisions. Have we ever seen a bigger us versus them scenario. Never. Have we ever been more afraid as a species? Never. So Noēsis thinks that far from political minutiae, no. We are acting naturally. We are choosing safety in numbers. That is tribal 101. We are frightened beings. The political minutiae are the variables within the constant of existential fear. Right? We are watching the degradation of what we didn't understand in the first place. That being needs to be comforted, not blamed.
Gotcha. Now, maybe I should have started here, but for some reason I thought it would be better like an hour in. The question of, because you quoted numbers of extinctions, 5 billion extinctions, and my question is really, if we become extinct and if we're on the path towards extinction, don't we deserve it?
Absolutely not. And here's why. I understand the question. Absolutely not. That's pretty risky. No. Under no circumstances do we deserve it. What injured thing deserves it?
Okay. That's a good point. Nobody deserves to, you don't deserve your broken leg. Absolutely not. But I think so. None of what we did to get here was conscious choice then, right? Because if we got here by our own conscious bad behavior,
no,
maybe that's a difficult point of disagreement that we didn't get to where we are.
Not disagreement. I like to think of it more of imparting information that you can't be expected to know. I do this for a living, man. The idea of, this goes back to the idea of blame. Here's a homework for you and your listeners. Go out and blame 10 people tomorrow and get back to me and tell me how that went. we don't respond to blame. Here's why. Blame's a threat. And some genius just decided long ago, hey, this rings cash registers. So let me be clear. We monetized a serial killer of human cultures. We blame. The blame rejection comes back. It spits out perpetual conflict. We can't concede a point. We'll go to our graves defending indefensible positions rather than concede a point. What the heck is going on when material fact will not change our mind? I'll tell you what's going on. We are fighting an enemy in our minds that died multiple eons ago. So if I can tell you that, and if I can then get busy showing it to you, now I bring value. We are injured. Noēsis is here to talk a human species that is fully suicidal off the ledge. Wow. We with a not guilty verdict, one we can defend by pointing to an injury that happened along our evolutionary timeline, one that we didn't understand even 50 years ago. And I find it interesting, Matt, that just as we need it, powers of human reason beckon us now to reason, and the information's there suddenly. An open window to self-discovery for our entire species, why we do what we do. Now we're junkies on describing what we do.
All right.
We're here to say, we're here to explain why we do what we do.
I get that. I think that's important. And I think I'm with you on 99% of what you said tonight, just because we are running out of time. And there's only so much bandwidth my brain can handle about that. I'm going to have to think about this conversation. I'm going to have to print out the transcript, go out and highlight things and think about it in deeper. And I encourage other people to do that as well. But the concept of blame, I think, maybe I'm wrong, and maybe you'll correct me on this, I think, because we're talking about evolution, I believe the concept of blame or our instinct to blame it's part of our DNA. It's part of what we've evolved into, right? So we're talking about evolution, and we're talking about losing something that we've evolved into, which is a blaming species.
With a heavy heart, I cannot concur. Blame descends from the injury. There is evolving human beings rolling along as a wheel. To collaborate or die, blame didn't come up for us. You know, it didn't come up. Blame descends from. Blame is a economic model, never a solution. I never blamed anyone that came that ever ended well. It's an economic model. So let's be clear. We monetize our killer, a fine mess. And I would like to end with clarifying a major point here. Are we the extinction guys? No. We are the non-extinction guys. We're here to avoid what need not be, because here's something that nobody's ever thought of. Extinction means the lights are out. 5 billion extinctions before this featured one thing in common for all of them, and that is that all of them committed to their demise long before the last of their kind fell. It's called commitment to extinction. When we do it, if we do it, there won't be any bells going off, no whistles, no emails will be sent. It will only be knowable in retrospect. And if we commit, it is a mathematical point past which we cannot reverse the reality. And I believe they call that cosmic Dunkirk. But not while I'm standing.
Not on my watch, he says.
This is an unreachable star, is it? Let me explain something. Human beings took flight 10 days after it was called impossible by the New York Times.
Yeah,
that's where I live.
We've done so many things that were once thought to be impossible. Absolutely, there's no denying that. And you know, there are more instances and examples of that than you could count in the world of people achieving the impossible. So you're absolutely right to have that optimism.
Matt. We are here to steer humanity away from the rocks of commitment.
All right, give me 6 weeks or a month to think about this, and then I'm going to invite you back because I want to have more of this conversation. But as I mentioned, there's only so much bandwidth in this little brain to absorb this conversation here tonight. For me to ruminate on it, think about it, send people to your website, which is noesisproject.com, and get some feedback from my audience on this and what they think about it. You got me very interested in this stuff. You know.
Thank you. You said some very nice things about the. It's an interesting subject. That means a lot to us. We are very, very interested in surviving. Why? We're working on four things right now: climate change, pandemic, nuclear, and disruptive technology. So clearly, we want to survive. But if we were to take care of all of those things, we will find to our horror that what we didn't take care of is our nature, our very nature.
Yeah.
So that's what we're here to do, to complete the team, not to diminish any other effort.
Well, what alternative do I have but to wish you success in this? Because the mission is one where humanity wins. And I don't think that's a bad thing. I mean, that's what we want. So of course I wish you success in this. It's not like I'm very confused by a lot of the concepts, obviously, because I just think it takes more than, you know, it takes moving a mountain to change human nature, change people's minds, change people's hearts.
But Matt, remember I said earlier that evolving human beings relied on bad news?
Yeah.
Let's do it again. I just gave everybody some really bad news. Now we have clarity. Now we can survive knowing the bad news and getting busy instead of just what we're doing. And that is kind of like waiting. But no, no more waiting. This is now. And the Noēsis is now.
Well, do please come back. Please come back pretty soon, and let's talk more about this after I get a chance to wrap my head around it a little more.
I can't thank you enough for all the time and all the very nice things that you said about this effort. Thank you.
It's been my pleasure. Be well until we meet again. Be well and much success to you. Noesisproject.com. It's in the link in the description. Thanks, Tony. Good night. Bye for now.
Thanks very much. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye.
Very, very interesting stuff. I would love to hear your thoughts on this. I just want to give you my quick, or as quickly as I can, thought that when he was talking about how bleak things look and the perception that, you know, it's right in front of us, this extinction event or idea of an extinction event is right in front of us. I was watching, as I do, rewatching my favorite subject, Ken Burns' documentary in Vietnam. And there's a clip at the end of the fourth or fifth episode where it talks about losing the war in Vietnam over here in America, riots in the streets, politically, all sorts of chaos over here. And the narrator's talking about how it felt like the seams were falling apart, like America had never been so divided since any time since the Civil War, and it felt like the world was about to end for a lot of people. And I think, and that's true, it did feel that way. But here we are 50 years later, and we did survive that. And I also thought about the things that were going on at the same time that seemed to have, I don't know, more celebratory stuff. They had Woodstock going on at the same time, all that kind of division and assassinations and all of the rioting in the streets and wars failing all over the world and people dying needlessly. I don't know what to make of that, but I know this idea of doomsday is not something new. And so on that level, I have to be a little bit optimistic that we thought we were on the ledge so many times before and pulled ourselves back from that. I don't know. I'd love to hear your thoughts. Info@minddogtv.com. Info@minddogtv.com. Let me know what you think. This is my last evening show for the week. I have two more morning shows, Coffee with the Dog tomorrow morning. Rocky El Paso will be my guest tomorrow morning. And William Conway will be the guest host with me. I hope you join me then. Have a great rest of your night. Thanks for coming in. Bye for now.